And welcome to today's lecture on hierarchical memory organization. In my last lecture, I have given enough background for hierarchical memory organization. We have discussed the basic characteristics of memory devices which are used in a computer system, and we shall see how the performance of memory system can be improved by using hierarchical memory organization. We shall start with the first level of memory hierarchy, that is done with the help of cache memory. So, what is a cache memory? Cache memory is a small first storage device that is introduced in between CPU and the slow main memory to improve average access time. So, this is the basic idea. Normally, as you know, you have got your CPU, central processing unit. I have already drawn this diagram, CPU, and it usually directly communicates. That means, before the cache memory was invented, the CPU used to directly communicate with the memory and IO devices. And this memory is known as main memory or prime memory. The reason for calling it main memory or prime memory is that to execute a program, it is very much essential that the program is present in the main memory. That means, for the execution of a program to fetch data, it is the memory which is accessed. So, that is why it is called main memory or prime memory. But as we have seen, that main memory, which is usually realized by using dynamic RAM, is slow, and we have also seen the speed of processor is increasing at a very high rate. The speed of dynamic RAM is not increasing at that rate. So, the gap is widening. So, we have to bridge the gap, and that can be done by using cache memory. So, what will be done? That CPU will not communicate with main memory directly. First, it will communicate with the cache memory, which is fast, much faster, and usually it is realized by using static RAM. Static RAM is used to realize this cache memory. So, it is much faster, maybe one order of magnitude faster compared to main memory realized by using dynamic RAM. But one point you must understand, the cache memory size is smaller. It may be faster, but it is much smaller in size. That means, a small portion of the main memory is present in the cache memory. Then question will arise, how do you improve the performance? Performance can be improved by exploiting spatial and temporal locality that is inherent in program execution, and this will help us to improve the performance even with a small cache size, and we shall see how it is being achieved. So, here you can see, here I have shown the main memory which is byte addressable. Is byte addressable, and let's assume the total size of main memory is 2 to the power n bytes, where n is the number of bits that is being generated by the CPU as address. That means the number of lines that comes out from the processor is n. This is the address bus, and so you can have a main memory size of 2 to the power n bytes. So, which is shown in this diagram. So, main memory is organization is shown here, the starting with 0, 1, 2. So, you have got 2 to the power n minus 1 bytes. However, whenever you organize it in this way, you can see that a word will comprise of several bytes. So, maybe say suppose you are considering 32 bit CPU. In such a case, you will be accessing 4 bytes. So, this is the word 1, 2, 3, 4. So, 4 bytes will be accessed simultaneously. So, this will form a word and which will be accessed simultaneously. That means, although the unit of reference is byte, but access is done by the CPU in terms of words. So, that this thing must be clear to you. So, for a 32 bit CPU, 4 bytes are accessed. For a 64 bit CPU, 8 bytes are accessed simultaneously, and accordingly the memory has to be organized. Now, let us see what is being done in case of cache memory. So, side by side we are trying to implement a cache memory, but cache memory will have much smaller size. Let us assume the total number of lines, usually it is specified in terms of lines, total number of lines is m, 0 to m. And in a particular cache, it is assumed that it has got k words in each line, which is called block. That means, you have got one block in one line. So, this is a block. I shall discuss about the other bits. So, this is a block which comprises several words, maybe let us assume 4 words. It is not mandatory that a block must have more than one word. Only one word may be present in a block, but as we shall see, to exploit the locality of references, more than one word is present in a block. So, few words are present in a block, that is what we shall assume. So, we have assumed that there are k words in each line. Then as I have already mentioned, the transfer between CPU and cache memory takes place in terms of word, because here CPU will want one word at a time. On the other hand, whenever the data which is not present in a cache, that means it is a, since a small portion of the main memory is present in the cache, you cannot expect that you will always find your instruction or data in the cache memory. So, whenever the data or instruction is not present in the cache memory, it is called cache miss. On the other hand, if the corresponding block is present in the cache, it is called cache hit. So, question arises, how do you identify cache miss and how do you identify cache hit? That we shall discuss in detail. But one point you have to remember, that whenever the cache miss occurs, you have to get the word that is required by the CPU from the main memory. So, from the main memory, the blocks are transferred. Now, you can see the transfer is not in terms of word. That means, whenever there is a miss, not just word is read from the main memory, but a block is transferred. So, here here the transfer takes place in terms of words, I mean sorry, in terms of block. A block, if several words are present in a block, all the words will be transferred one after the other, although CPU will require only one word at that moment. That means, once the block is transferred to the cache memory, only one word will be used by the processor at that moment, and the other words which is being transferred from main memory to the cache will be used subsequently. So, the basic operation can be explained with the help of this flow chart, although everything happens in hardware, but for the purpose of explanation, the way the cache memory works can be explained with the help of this flow chart. So, first thing that is being done, receive address from the CPU. That means, the CPU generates an address which has been stated as RA, receive address, from, and that address is applied to the memory system. And then what has to be done? The memory has to find out whether a block is present in the, whether the block containing RA is in cache. That means, the, as I told, you have to find out, rather the memory system has to find out whether a particular word which is being asked by the CPU is present in the cache or not. So, if the answer is yes, then it is very simple. If the corresponding instruction or data which is present in the cache memory is delivered to the CPU from the cache memory. So, here, since the cache memory is faster, whenever it goes through this path, it is quite fast, and the operation is per completed. Now, the what happens whenever the corresponding word which has been requested by the CPU is not present in the cache? How that can be identified, we shall discuss little later, but let us assume it is not present, then we call that cache miss. So, cache miss has occurred. So, what has to be done? The memory system will automatically access the main memory for block containing the RA, that means the receive address. Then one thing has to be done, the block which has been read from the main memory has to be stored in the cache memory. So, you have to allocate cache slot for main memory block. So, once a block is read, it has to be stored in one of the blocks, one of the lines. So, you have got m lines, in one of the lines it has to be stored. So, question arise, that means, that is called allocation of a particular line. Which, to which line it will be stored, we shall discuss later, how that is being identified. That is another important thing you should understand. You have got m lines, it has to be, one of the lines has to be allocated for the word, for the block that is being transferred from the main memory to the cache memory. Then deliver the RA, deliver RA word to the CPU. So, once you have transferred the block to the cache memory and stored it in the allocated cache slot, the requested word can be transferred to the CPU, and load main memory block into the cache slot. So, it will be done together. So, whether you load it in the cache slot first or you deliver to the CPU, that is immaterial, because once you have read it from the main memory, it can be immediately transferred to the CPU, and then of course, it can be loaded into the cache. Why these two has been separated? The reason for that is, you can see that your bus may be by width of the bus can be same as the size of the word. So, if you have to transfer multiple words, it will require multiple memory cycles. So, which can be deferred if necessary for later time. So, and then that is being done. So, this is in nutshell the way the cache memory works. Now, let us consider several issues. One important issue is the size of the cache. with respect to the main memory. We have seen that small, it should be small enough so that the average cost is closer to the main memory. So, if the cache size is very large, then cost will be high. And not only cost will be high, whenever you make the size of the memory larger, it will be slower as well. Because you know, if you look into the details of the implementation of cache memory, which is realized by using static RAM, there is a decoder portion, address decoder. That address decoder will be more and more complex as the size of the memory is larger, and that makes it slower. So, it has to be small from two viewpoints. Number one, the cost should be smaller because cache memory is costlier. Second is it has to be fast. So, from that consideration, the size of the cache memory should be small. But another is it should be large enough so that the speed is closer to the cache memory. So, this is another requirement. So, if we want that the cache memory should be smaller from one angle, another angle is cache memory should be larger. Why it should be larger? Then most of the time the processor will find the instruction or data in the cache memory. And so, the access time will reduce, the speed will be closer to the cache memory. So, these two are conflicting requirements. So, you have to do optimization. So, it should not be too large, it should not be too small. So, the cache size is between 1K to 512K. So, you may be asking why such a wide range. The reason for that is in the early years when memory was very costly, when cache was introduced first, size of the cache was pretty small. And as the with the advancement of VLSI technology, the cost as well as performance of cache memory has improved. Cost has reduced, performance has improved. And as a result, with the advancement of time, the cache memory size has also increased. So, as a result, you will find in modern processors, size of the cache memory is not 1K. 1 kilobyte here, byte is not mentioned. So, you will consider always in terms of byte. So, 64K or 128K or 256K or 512K. These are the typical cache memory sizes which are present in the modern contemporary processors. So, it has been found that this gives optimum result. So, satisfying these two contradictory requirements, you have arrived at some compromise which gives you optimum result. That means, it is it is not very small, not very large, and it gives you speed closer to the cache memory, but cost closer to the speed closer to the cache memory and speed also closer to the cache memory. Okay. That is number one issue. Second issue is where can a block be placed? So, I have already mentioned about that question. You see, you will be reading a block from the main memory and you have to allocate one of the cache line to store that block. So, that this is the question, and that question is answered by what is known as mapping. So, as there are fewer lines in cache than main memory blocks, suitable technique for mapping of main memory blocks into the cache line is necessary. So, you have to develop, you have to use appropriate mapping technique, and it has been found that the mapping functions can be divided into three basic categories. So, here the first one mapping first one is known as only one place corresponding to one block of main memory, to a block of main memory. That means So, if you read a word from a main memory, say maybe from here, and it will always go to a fixed line that is fixed. So, there is a kind of one to, I mean it is not really one to one, it is because many blocks of main memory will actually map to one of the locations. So, it is many blocks will map to one block. So, it is a many to one mapping. So, it is a many to one mapping, because you have got many blocks and each of them, although the line is fixed, but to where it will go, I mean that is fixed. That means several such, for example, this block may also map to this location, to this particular line. So, but that is fixed, that is not changed. So, this is called one place is fixed, and that is known as direct mapping. I shall elaborate this technique in detail little later. Then second possibility is that you can have few places. That means there are few alternatives, you are introducing some flexibility. That flexibility is that instead of always storing in a particular line, you can have more than one alternative, 2 or 4 or 8, limited number. So, you can store either in this line, or maybe there is another alternative line, you can store in this line, in one of the two lines, in one of the two places. So, you can have few places. So, this is little more flexibility that is being added, and later on we shall see how this improves the performance and at what cost. Then the third alternative is any place. Actually, these two have changed places. Actually, any place will be associative mapping. That means few places is known as set associative mapping. That means one of the sets can be used for placing, and last alternative is any place, that is your associative mapping, fully associative mapping. That means a particular block from the main memory can be stored anywhere. That is known as associative mapping and fully associative mapping or associative mapping. So, these are the three alternatives which have been explored, and we shall see their advantages and disadvantages. So, these three techniques that I have mentioned has led to three possible ways by which you can identify where a block has to go. First technique is known as indexing. That means there is a fixed place, one place for a particular block in main memory where it can be stored. That is done by a technique called indexing. Second is done by limited search, that is set associative. That means some search will be performed within the cache to identify where it can be placed, and then full search, that means to which line it has to be stored, by using a full search it will be found out, and there it can be stored in appropriate place by based on some policy which I shall discuss little later. So, this is done by first breaking down an address into three parts. What are the three parts? So, the address which is generated by the CPU is this. This is the address which is generated by the CPU. Now, this can be divided into three parts. First part is block offset. What do you mean by block offset? Within a particular block, how many bytes are present? This will be specified in this part. That means, suppose we assume that a particular block, has got 4 words and each word of 4 bytes, let us assume. Then how many bits do you require in the block offset? So, for 4 words you will require 2 bit to identify which one of these words, and 2 bit is required to identify which byte of the 4 bytes. So, you require 4 bits. So, you will require 4 bits to as block offset whenever you have got 4 words in the cache and each word is of 4 bytes. If you have got only 1 word present, then say 1 word, as I said, that is also a possibility. So, in such a case, this particular bits will not be required. So, you will require only 2 bit as part of the block offset. So, essentially the block offset bits identifies different bytes that is present within a block. Now, remaining part is used for the purpose of identifying the block. So, this is known as block address. Now, this block address is present, and this block address is again divided into 2 parts. Second part is known as index. This is the index. Question arises, what do you mean by index and how many bits are to be present in the index? Actually, this index finds out, say you have got m lines present in the cache, 0 to m. So, how many bits do you require to identify one of the lines? You will require log 2 m lines, and that is actually specified by the index. So, index specifies the address part which identifies which of this line is present in the cache. I mean, one of the lines, it points to the line where there is a possibility of storing that particular block. So, indexing that index field, from the index field it points to the cache memory. Now, why do you need the third part? So, you have already identified a particular place in the cache where a block can be stored, but as I said, it is many to one mapping, and there are, if there are if the number of bits present here, depending on the number of bits present here, there will be so many alternatives. Say if the number of bits present here is n, not n, n is usually specified to at the that address size, and this can be say k, say let it be some number L. So, you can have 2 to the power L different blocks which can be mapped to the cache memory line having the same index. So, one of the 2 to the power L blocks has to be will be present here. Question naturally arises, which block of main memory it is. So, that has to be found out by a technique known as by putting the tag as part of the cache memory. So, here you are storing the tag, this value, this is known as tag, is stored along with data. Not only data, but tag fields, that is the higher order bits, are stored in the cache memory. So, what will be done? This will be compared with this tag, and if they match, then you know that particular block which is referenced by the cache memory, I mean which is referenced by the processor, is present. That means, cache hit will occur if this matches with this tag. On the other hand, if this does not match with this tag field, then it is miss. That means, if this is hit, if it is not, then it is miss. So, you can see the role of the three different fields I have discussed in detail, and later on when I shall discuss about the different types of mapping, how they are used, we shall discuss. So, we find, let us consider a following system. Addresses are of 32 bits, which is generated by the CPU. The block frame size is 2 to the power 4, 4 bytes. That means, this is the size of the block, which has been assumed to be of 1 word. Let us assume 32 bit processor. So, the cache is 64 kilobyte. That means, you have got 2 to the power 16 bytes that is present in the cache. And since 4 bytes are present in each block, and what will be the total number of lines, which is also called block frames, that is 2 to the power 14. So, for each cache block brought in from the memory, there is a single possible frame among the 2 to the power 14 available. That means, 2 to the power 14 available, this is the size, this is the number of frames or lines which is present, and you have to compare the tag to identify whether a particular address that has been generated by the CPU is present at that moment or not. So, this is being elaborated here. As you can see, your address is 32 bit, and these 2 bits 0, 1 is used as byte offset, I mean block offset. Then R is the number of bits that is used for the purpose of indexing. So, since we have already seen that you require 14 bits for the purpose of indexing. So, 2 to 15, 14 bits are used for the purpose of indexing, and remaining 16 bits are used as tag. So, the number of blocks in main memory is 2 to the power s, that is the number of blocks. So, in this particular case, it is 16 plus 14, 2 to the power 30 is the number of blocks in main memory, and the number of lines in cache memory is m, which is equal to 2 to the power r. And so, this is how and address length is s plus w, s is the block address plus the block offset. So, together forms the address length. So, you can see we have this is what will be stored in the cache memory. Your data will be present, which is 32 bit, assuming that 32 bit processor. Then 16 bits you will require as tag field. Oh, you see, there is another bit is present, V. What do you really mean by V? There is a, now your cache comprises three fields. First part is data, where useful information that will be required by the CPU is stored. Then, as we have seen, you will require to store the tag corresponding to different frames or lines. One tag is required for each line. Now, another bit has been added, V, that is called the valid bit. Why do you need this? Why do you need another additional bit? Need for the valid bit arises because whenever you turn the computer on, your cache is blank. There is nothing, no information, no useful data is present in the cache. So, it is full of garbage. So, you have to take into account that situation as well. So, that means when the computer is turned on, the valid bit of all the lines is set to 0. That means, what is done in the beginning, all the valid bits of the line all are turned 0, all are 0, all are 0. Now, suppose the CPU generates an address and whenever the address is generated by the CPU, using the index field, it will point to a particular line. Let us assume it points to this line, and if the valid bit is 0, which will immediately indicate that the corresponding data or instruction is not present in the cache memory. So, that means if V is equal to 0, then cache miss. So, what will be done then? At that time, you will be fetching it from the main memory, as you have seen, and after you fetch it in the main from the main memory and you store your data here and store the tag field here, then it will be set to 1. So, there will be a tag field present here and data present here. Once that is stored, then the valid bit is 1, is set to 1. Now, next time whenever if the index field is same, then that time not only this valid bit will be checked, but this tag will be compared with the higher order bits of the address to check. That means the tag field has to match, which I shall elaborate in the, with the help of this diagram. As you can see here, you have got 32 bit address. These two are block offset or byte offset, which is identical at this moment, because one block comprises only one word. So, that is why byte offset and block offset is same in this case. And this index field is used to point to a particular frame in the cache. So, this has been pointed. So, what it does, it first checks whether the valid bit is 0 or not. If it is 0, then this hit will be 0. It is an AND gate. If it is 0, output will be 0. That means it is a miss. Only when it is 1, then it is hit. Now, in addition to that, it will compare the higher order 16 bit with this tag field, which is the tag field that is being stored at the time of bringing in the block to the cache memory. So, this tag field will be this tag field will be compared with these higher order address lines of the which is known as tag field of the address, and if they are same, then this will be 1. So, tag has to match, and the valid bit also has to be 1 to get a hit. That means if the tag does not match, even when the valid bit is 1, it will be a miss, because it is a many to one mapping. So there is a possibility that that particular cache line does not corresponding to this address. So in such a case, in spite of the fact it is the valid bit is 1, you will not get hit because the tag field is not matching. Now question arises, you can see the relationship between the number of lines, number of bits, which is given here, where I is the cache line number. Cache line number means that is the that the cache line number in the cache memory. How do you find it out? I is equal to j mod m, where m is the number of lines that is present in the cache. Now it is very easy to do it do it by breaking it up in this manner. That means you have to take j mod m. So we have seen in our case the j is the number of blocks that is present, and we have found out that is equal to 2 to the power s. J is equal to 2 to the power s. 2 to the power s, and on the other hand your that m, that mod m is equal to 2 to the power r. So how it can be easily found out? So this will be equal to 2 to the power s minus r. So that is actually the value of j main memory, that is how you can find out. This is I is equal to 2 to the power s mod 2 to the power a. So this I is found out, that index is found out by this. So this will be equal to this by this. So that is how you can get this value, and this is the relationship, and I is equal to j mod m that is used for the purpose of direct mapping. Okay. Now you can see here how the mapping in mapping takes place in direct mapping. As I have told that it is a many to one mapping. So you can see a single cache line is being mapped by so many main memory blocks. So these main memory blocks can be assigned to this cache line 0th, mth, then 2mth, 3mth, in this way 2 to the power s minus m. Similarly, the first cache line will be mapped by 1 plus m plus 1 plus 2m plus 1, in this way it will go up to 2 to the power s minus m plus 1. And the last line m minus 1 line, that will be mapped by that m minus 1th block of the main memory, or 2m minus 1th block of the main memory, and in this way it will go up to 2 to the power s plus 1. So you can see this is how it takes place in case of direct mapping. Now let me elaborate this. This particular thing has been shown in this example. You can see this is the different main memory blocks which are mapping to a single cache line. So in this particular case you have got 16 kilobyte of main memory and 4 kilobyte of cache memory. So you have got 4 kilobyte of cache memory and 16 kilobyte of cache main memory. So you can see accordingly the byte offset is 2 bits, and 14 bit is required that is the total number of bytes in the cache memory, because it is 4 kilobytes, and out of which 12 bit is required for the purpose of in 10 sorry you require 10 bits, because it is 4 kilobyte. That means you will have 1k lines. So 1k lines for addressing purpose you will require 10 bits. So, 10 plus 2, 12, and you have got only 4 bits for the tag field. So, what does it mean? That 4 bits in the tag field means 2 to the power 4 different blocks of the main memory can map to a single cache line. So, you can see this is the 16 different blocks of the main memory can map to this, and that can be found out from the tag field. Tag field identifies which one of these blocks is present. Let me explain this with a much simpler example. Suppose your main memory has got 2 to the power 5 blocks, let us assume. You have got 2 to the power 5 blocks, and your cache memory has got only 2 to the power 3 blocks. So, that means you have got 8 lines are present here. So, this is your cache, and your main memory has got 0th and 2 to the power 5 minus 1. This is the, I have considered block, I have not stated in terms of words or bytes. So, it is in terms of blocks only. So, one of the 2 to the power 5 blocks will be here. Now, it is divided into 3 fields, V, index, and then data. Now, suppose the first an address, let us assume the address here, the index fields will be start with 000 and it is 111, and here it is 00000 and it is 11111, 5 lines. Now, suppose block address that is generated by the processor is 01010. This is the address which is generated by the processor. Now, where it will search? It will search where it is 01, that means this part it will be done. So, this part will be used, this will be used, these 3 bits will be used for the purpose of indexing. So, this is 00001 01 0 01 0 11 100 then 101 110 and 111. So, 010 it will point to this, indexing will be done here. So, once this address is generated, it will search this line, indexing is done by this field. So, this bit will be, initially it was 0, now it will be set to 1, and you will write 01, this is the tag field in this, and the corresponding data that is present in this location 01010 will be stored here. Now, suppose subsequently the CPU generates another address that is equal to A is equal to 00101. So, in such a case it will this index bit will point to 101 is this one, and then this 0 bit will become 1, and it will write 00, and corresponding data will be stored here. Now, suppose the address that is being generated next time, third address that is being generated is 10010. So, 10010 address has been generated, 010 is matching with this. So, it will point to this. Now, you can see this bit is 1, however, this is 01 and this is 10. So, at this moment there will be a cache miss, in spite of the fact some data is present here, but it is not matching with this address, the third address being that is generated, and this will be a miss, and this will be replaced by 10 at this moment, and correspondingly the data which is being stored here will be replaced. So this is how it will work. So I have illustrated with a very small main memory and cache memory. So in real life processors, obviously the number of bits that is present that is used for addressing, indexing, and number of bits in the tags will be much larger. Now this is how it is done in direct mapping, and as you can see it is quite simple. Directly from the address bits you can find out, you can separate out the index field which will be applied to the cache memory, then comparison can be done with the tag field, and by checking the valid bit field it will identify whether the hit is there or it is miss. But this direct mapping has a number of disadvantages. The various disadvantages are, number one is fixed cache location for a main memory word. So as I have already mentioned that direct mapping gives you a fixed location for a given main memory block. So for a given main memory block, this a particular line is fixed. So two words with the same index bit, index but different tag value, cannot reside in the cache simultaneously. So this is a serious restriction, because only one can be stored. So two words with the same index but different tag value cannot reside in the cache simultaneously. What does it mean? That means, for example, these two words A101010 and 10010, these two are generated one after the other. If it is a direct mapping, each time, say suppose alternately this is being generated, each time there will be a miss. That means, since two main memory having the same index field cannot reside simultaneously, this will always lead to a miss. So this particular restriction can be overcome by using other type of mapping, as we shall see. So as I have explained with the help of this example, this is vulnerable to continuous swapping. So continuous swapping will take place in such a case, and this can be overcome by using other type of mapping like say associative mapping, where it will do full search. So this is another extreme. In the earlier case our restriction was that only one address can be used, and one frame or line can be used to store. Now in this case the extreme is that you can store any block in any line. That is your associative mapping. But in such a case, what you have to do, you have to compare the tags of all the lines simultaneously with the tag that is being read, that is coming with the processor, coming from the CPU. So you have to do what is known as parallel search. That means you have to search in parallel in all the cases. So you can see, although I have shown only one comparator, you will require the number of comparators will be equal to the number of lines or number of frames that is present in your cache memory. So this associative mapping allows any main memory block to be mapped into any cache line. So this is the flexibility you are achieved, but this makes this cache very costly, and this type of cache is known as content addressable memory or CAM, because you are using a part of that address to be stored in the memory and used for checking. And obviously this will give better performance, and but it is extremely expensive to implement. So we find that the we have got two extremes: direct mapping and fully associative mapping. So both of them have their own advantages and limitations. Now in my next lecture I shall discuss about another technique which is known as set associative mapping, which tries to achieve best of both the worlds. That means good features of direct mapping and good features of fully associative mapping. It will try to incorporate in that particular technique, that is known as set associative mapping, which I shall discuss in my next lecture. Thank you.